Thank you. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3214 in the name of Linda Fabiani on Marie Curie's Great Daffodil Appeal. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? And I call on Linda Fabiani to open the debate. 7 minutes or thereabout, Ms. Fabiani.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted yet again to be hosting what has now become an annual debate about the fantastic work that is carried out by Marie Curie. And it focuses generally around the Great Daffodil Appeal. And this year is, in fact, the 31st year of the Marie Curie Daffodil Appeal. And over that time, more than £80 million has been raised. I want to thank all my colleagues who are here and also those who signed the motion. And that's because I don't think there's anyone in this Parliament that doesn't recognise the importance, both personally and professionally, of the care and support that is given by this organisation, Marie Curie, to over 8,000 people and their families every year in Scotland, in their own homes. So very important. A couple of years ago, the debate that we had round about this time in the middle of the Daffodil Appeal was about the right of people to choose where they wanted to receive their palliative care. And that was very much led by Marie Curie and other agencies. And I believe has led to a much wider discussion about palliative care generally and a commitment from this Parliament and government to look at proper palliative care strategies. So important. But you know, my colleagues will cover a lot of that, but I want to use my time to celebrate the work of the Marie Curie volunteers. There's more than 1,850 of them across Scotland, 80 groups, there's the helper service, there's 37 shops, and there's a lot of them here today in the gallery. A host of beautiful golden daffodils right round our Parliament, and a couple of guys too. But it's okay for me to say that because today is International Women's Day and we're celebrating women, and it's a fine day to be celebrating the volunteers of Marie Curie. There's so much help given by the Marie Curie charity for those with terminal illness and in supporting those who support those with terminal illness. And there's a lot of issues that are covered. People don't realise the work involved in what the professionals in Marie Curie do and what the volunteers do. Lots of different things. Things that affect people who end up in difficult situations in their life, that are the practical day-to-day things that need to be addressed just to give some comfort, some ease of mind, and as much of a sense of well-being as can be given in such a difficult time. I jotted a couple of them down, and as I say, my colleagues will no doubt cover some of them. Social security, that's a major issue, you know, for those who face having to leave work, having to have a drop in income at a time of terminal illness. And Marie Curie, and indeed other charities, have been working hard on this. They've been feeding into our own government's consultation in social security. And I believe very strongly that the response that came from the Scottish Government, and I think welcomed generally by people right across this Parliament, that the system that we're responsible for in Scotland should have dignity, fairness and respect at the heart of it. Again, a lot of that has been informed by organisations like Marie Curie putting their point of views forward. I know that my colleague George Adam intends to talk a bit more about this because I overheard him and talking to somebody about it and when we were getting a drink of water, and I thought, right, I better not belabour that too much. That's his thing this evening. Another issue is about mental health. And again, we have a mental health strategy coming up, and I know that Marie Curie have been giving evidence to that and speaking to people. I can't begin to imagine the absolute strain on your mental health and well-being of caring for somebody in a protracted time in a palliative care sense. somebody you love very, very much. I've had a touch of it with family over the years, but not the depth of it that must come when it's your lifelong partner, or if it's a child, or a parent that you've been very close to. I certainly can't begin to imagine how difficult it must be to be that person who's told that you have a terminal illness and that you're going to die. So I think the mental health and well-being promotion that Marie Curie are running just now is extremely important for so many, many people. And I hope others here talk more about that today, and I'd like to talk about that more with Marie Curie. So that's where Marie Curie helps. All these things, I don't have time at all to go into the work they're doing about the joint integrated boards on health and social care and the information they've been putting forward for that. Again, hugely important, quick assessments, the right for fast tracking to finance to help make that journey as stress-free as possible for people. So Marie Curie do all that stuff, all the information that they produce. There's some, the stall that they've had in Parliament this week, some fascinating books, more than just leaflets, books about how people can cope, but also about the practicalities that help you cope. Great work. Yes, the professional staff are great. Yes, the helpline's great. But I'll tell you what, these volunteers do absolutely fantastic work. The helper service, I haven't had time to go into any great length because I know that Elaine is one of the speakers at the reception and she will tell us about the fantastic work that the helper service does, only in some areas so far in Scotland, but I hope that that can be expanded. So it's way beyond, I think, anything that has been done before by volunteers. It's on the way to the service that is given by many professionally, but we have these Marie Curie volunteers who choose, because of their own personal experiences in most cases, I would imagine, to give up their own time to help people. Very often people they don't know, but they do know that these people just need a helping hand, and we're very, very lucky if we can go through life and never need a helping hand. So, welcome again to our Marie Curie volunteers. Delighted to host you in your Parliament. We can talk more at the reception as it comes up. And what I would say to you is wear your daffodil with pride every year because you deserve to. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Can I also welcome the many in the public gallery, but politely ask you to decline from applauding. I understand why you want to, but it's not permitted in the Scottish Parliament. We have 11 members wishing to speak in this debate, and due to the number of members, I'm minded to accept a motion under Rule 8.14.3 that the debate be extended by 30 minutes. And I invite Ms. Fabiani to move that motion, please.
I've always wanted to do this, Presiding Officer. Formally moved.
Are we all agreed, though? Thank you. All right, I now move to open debate. I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Donna Cameron. Ms. Mackay, please.
I'd like to thank Linda Fabiani for bringing forward this important debate. Marie Curie nurses give people with a terminal illness choice and dignity. Put simply, they are a fantastic charity. They make it possible for people faced with a terminal illness to have the choice to die peacefully in their own homes, surrounded by the people they love. You simply cannot put a price on the work they do, as Linda has outlined. Currently, there are nearly 2,200 Marie Curie nurses working across the UK, caring for people with terminal illnesses in their own homes. None of us know when or if we will need the support of Marie Curie nurses, but we should all be eternally grateful that if we do, they will be there. The Great Daffodil Appeal is Marie Curie's biggest annual fundraising campaign. From wearing a daffodil pin to organising large gala dinners and small bake sales, there are countless ways for people to get involved. There are Marie Curie fundraising groups in my constituency in Bishop Briggs, Kirkintilloch, Lenzie and Bearsden doing great work, and there are just some of the 85 groups in Scotland who've raised over £4 million. The Marie Curie Memorial Foundation was established in 1948, and the first Marie Curie home for cancer patients was opened in 1952 in Cupar, Fife. Today, 9 hospices across the UK offer round-the-clock care and support in a welcoming environment for people staying in hospices and those coming in for daycare. Marie Curie is the largest provider of hospice beds outside the NHS. The Great Daffodil Appeal and the funds it generates ensures that this can continue and develop. Marie Curie is also one of the UK's leading funders in palliative care research funding. However, Presiding Officer, 11,000 people who need palliative care in Scotland each year are not accessing it. That's 1 in 4 people who need palliative care missing out. That's why I welcome the Scottish Government's strategic framework on palliative and end-of-life care, which sets out a vision that everyone who needs palliative care has access to it by 2021. The Government has also committed to doubling the amount of palliative care services in the community through its recently published Health and Social Care Delivery Plan. Presiding Officer, on International Women's Day, it seems fitting that we remember the remarkable women who made all this possible. Marie Curie was one of 5 children born into a poor family in Poland in 1867. She had an insatiable appetite for learning, and through sheer determination, she entered Sorbonne University in Paris, where she read physics and mathematics. Her discovery of radium and polonium, for which she and her husband Pierre Curie won the Nobel Peace Prize, has saved millions of lives throughout the world. She was the first woman to win a Nobel Peace Prize, the first person to win it twice, and the only person to win it for 2 different sciences. What a legacy to leave to the world. Presiding Officer, with an increasingly ageing population, we must ensure that our terminally ill are treated with respect and dignity and can die peacefully where they choose. So I urge everyone to get involved in the Great Daffodil Appeal in any way you can. Every daffodil counts, and as the great Marie Curie herself said, one never notices what has been done. One can only see what remains to be done. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I remind members it's 4-minute speeches. I call Donald Cameron to be followed by George Adam. Mr. Cameron, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like both to thank and commend Linda Fabiani for tabling this motion so that all parliamentarians have the opportunity not only to highlight the excellent work carried out by Marie Curie, but also to talk about the importance of the Great Daffodil Appeal and the various people it helps. I'd also like to take the opportunity to pay tribute to everyone who works for or who volunteers for Marie Curie and has helped this campaign run for 31 years and counting, raising over £80 million since 1986, as the motion states. That's a remarkable achievement and is testament to the dedication of those involved in this charity and in its vital work of supporting people with terminal illness. It's also poignant that this debate comes on International Women's Day, which is, of course, today. Marie Curie herself was truly an international woman of great stature. She was indomitable. As Rona Mackay has noted, she was a woman of many firsts, the first to develop her theories, the first to become a professor at the University of Paris, and most notably, the first woman to win a Nobel Prize, doing so twice in her life. Of course, her legacy has continued through the work of Marie Curie, the charity, which was set up in 1948. And as the motion notes, Marie Curie currently provides expert support for around 8,000 people and their families every year in Scotland and operates across all but one local authority. However, around 11,000 people with a terminal condition will not receive any end-of-life support for a variety of reasons. As Marie Curie highlights, one of the main reasons is the planning of social care. We know that the issue of delayed discharge in Scotland's hospitals is an ongoing concern, and whilst I don't seek to make an overtly political point in a debate such as this, we must note that it is incredibly distressing for those who are in a terminal condition not to be supported through their end-of-life journey, either in their community or in their home, if that is their choice, but are prevented from doing so. As Marie Curie's report, Dying to Care, acknowledged, communication between the NHS and social care services through health and social care partnerships in the new world of integration needs to be better. The work that Marie Curie carry out in my own Highlands and Islands region is vital in supporting the NHS and importantly allowing recipients to remain at home while receiving care. And at this point, I'd like to welcome in particular representatives from fundraising groups from Orkney, Moray, Thurso and the Isle of Bute, who are here in the gallery today, as well as the many nursing staff from my region who are also here. In the Highlands and Islands region, around 8,800 people die each year from a terminal condition, and 6,500 have a palliative care need. And it is deeply worrying that around a quarter of Scots with such a need will not receive access to it. As a party, we are supportive of the general aims behind the strategic framework already mentioned. And while measures such as these should be achievable in urban Scotland, the greater challenge will be in remote and rural Scotland, where we know specialist care services are limited and often difficult to access. I would also like to commend the Helper service. There is such a service in the Highlands and Islands covering Argyll and Bute, which was launched last year with funding from the Big Lottery Fund and investment from Marie Curie. And I know the new Helper manager, Alison Craig, from Argyll and Bute is here, and I would like to take this chance to wish her luck in her new job. The service is a vital lifeline for many people, providing companionship and emotional support, as well as practical help for those struggling to get by with their respective conditions. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, very few charity campaigns have such a high profile or recognisable public image, such as the Great Daffodil Appeal. Rather like World AIDS Day and the Red Ribbon, the yellow daffodil is a powerful emblem of this fantastic long-running campaign, and I'm sure that we all wish it every luck in the future.
Thank you very much. I call George Adam to be followed by Colin Smith. Mr Adam, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate, as Linda Fabiani has already said, is one of the many debates that we have on a yearly basis, and it's one that I personally always look forward to, because, and I thank Linda Fabiani for bringing it to us again, because there's a number of reasons why I actually do enjoy taking part in this event. And one is that personally I do feel a closeness to the charity. It's not because of any personal reasons or but it's because of the fundraisers, the people who have been involved in my constituency in Paisley. They are here tonight, Presiding Officer, and they do a power of work with fundraising, having raised over 100,000 over a 5-year period for Marie Curie. This, of course, is always a big day for them, as you would be able to tell by looking at their social media feeds as they were coming here today. Because, Presiding Officer, there's nothing wrong with having a wee bottle of Prosecco on your journey over to Edinburgh. It is a case of Team Paisley on tour. They deserve that day out, because all the work and the fundraising that they've done in the past for Marie Curie, and this is one of the days that they get the opportunity to do it. I've got another reason to obviously they've attended here tonight. It's Jane Cumming, Julie Maguire and Lynn Wilson, and they make Marie Curie very, very real for me. And I think I'm an individual that if you're going to work for a group or work for an organisation, you've got to feel it. It's got to be part of it. And they make it very real because of their own personal stories and also the hard work that they do. And they even went to a stage over the past 3 years, Presiding Officer, where I have walked in fire. I know many think I can walk in water, but this was just fire in itself. And we managed last year to raise £20,000 at that event based at, I was going to say St Mirren Park, but it's Paisley 2021 Stadium now. But basically we had a very good night, and it's always a great event because there's always so many positive people there, and they've all been brought together by probably in some cases something negative that's happened in their life, and that's where people get a lot of great strength and support from it as well. But there's another reason that's very personal to me as well, was from my own perspective, and I'll talk about palliative care here, is my own mother had cancer and ended up in the Accord Hospice in Paisley. But there was a point when we were going through that process where the hospital said to me that your mother's missed that window of opportunity to go and get the palliative care. We think she might end up dying in the hospital. Now, my answer wasn't, do you know who I am? I'm going to make sure she goes. It was, I'm going to physically pick my mother up and take her to the Accord Hospice if I have to carry her all the way along myself. And that's the part when we're talking about the very personal stories of individuals. Like Marie Curie tells us that 11,000 people need palliative care in Scotland and are not getting access to it. And it's good news that the Scottish Government's strategic framework in palliative care and end-of-life care promises that everyone who needs palliative care will get access to it by 2021, because these are the people that we have to make sure we're looking after as well, because it is a very difficult time in your life and extremely emotional, and that's the last thing you need. And I can see the difference it made to my mother having her last hours and days there. I'll try not to greet halfway through this debate, but as a member of the Social Security Committee in the Scottish Parliament, I'm interested to see what Marie Curie had to say about and other charities with regards to personal independence payments and PIP and the assessments at the DWP. And it's too long, the process that goes through for people who have a terminal illness. We hear stories constantly of people who die before actually they get their assessment. And one of the things for me is I'm glad to hear that that is one of the 15% of benefits that are going to come over to the Scottish Government. And I know that the Minister's already in record, the Minister for Social Security, and saying that we're going to address this and make sure that we can deal with this as well. Because I think when you're at a stage like that with families and they need that time to kind of make sure everyone's okay, the last thing you need to worry about is going through that uncaring process. But on closing, Presiding Officer, I just want everybody to have a great night. The volunteers deserve it. This is their night. They can have as much Prosecco as they like because I think they enjoy it for, they deserve it for the work that they've done. And as I say, I hope everyone enjoys themselves. And unfortunately, I won't be able to spend any time with them tonight because I've got other business to do in the constituency business. But I hope they enjoy it and I wish them all the very best for the future.
Thank you, Mr. Adam. Colin Smith to be followed by Graham Day, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my Register of Members' Interest, which states I was employed by Parkinson's UK when I was elected, although that employment has ceased. Can I also echo the comments of other members in thanking Linda Fabiani, who I know is a long-standing supporter of Marie Curie, for securing this debate. As Linda Fabiani and others have commented, that the fantastic work of Marie Curie makes a real difference in all our communities at what is a deeply difficult and emotional time for families. In my own South Scotland region, around 1,000 people are supported by that work, such as the compassionate care many received from dozens of wonderful Marie Curie nurses in the region. Much of that work is only possible because of the annual Great Daffodil Appeal, which has been raising both funds and awareness for over 30 years. But it's also because of the group of people Linda Fabiani rightly paid particular tribute to, and that's the army of volunteers who support Marie Curie, whether through fundraising, helping in one of the Marie Curie shops, or the more recently established Marie Curie Helper Service. Now, prior to being elected to Parliament, I did have the privilege of working for Parkinson's UK, supporting and coordinating their volunteers, and I saw it firsthand the real difference they made to people living with Parkinson's. And it's the same with Marie Curie's Helper Service volunteers, including the 20 in my own region of Dumfries and Galloway, some of whom are here this evening, although I'm going to refrain from speculating on whether or not they had Prosecco in the train on the way here. But whether it's providing a friendly ear for someone living with a terminal illness, allowing families and carers to take a few hours' break while the volunteer provides care, the work of those helper service volunteers, and indeed all of Marie Curie's volunteers, is simply invaluable. Excuse me, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of a whole chamber in simply saying thank you. As well as paying tribute to the work of Marie Curie, and in particular those volunteers, this debate, however, is also a chance to discuss issues around end-of-life and palliative care. It's over a year since the Health and Sport Committee published its thorough and far-reaching report, We Need to Talk About Palliative Care. And this was followed by the publication of the Scottish Government Strategic Framework for Action on Palliative Care and End-of-Life Care, with its vision that everyone in Scotland who needs care has access to it by 2021. Now, there won't be a member in this chamber who doesn't share that vision, but we all know more still needs to be done over the next 5 years to turn that vision into a reality. I had the privilege of holding my first members' debate in this chamber recently on Marie Curie's excellent report, Enough for Everyone, Challenging Inequities in Palliative Care, a report which highlighted that one in four people who die in Scotland miss out on vital palliative care. And as Rona Mackay, Donald Cameron, George Adam all said, that's 11,000 people a year in Scotland. Although it's not an exhaustive list, the report also showed that those aged over 85, those from Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities, those who live alone, and those who live in areas of deprivation were the least likely to receive palliative care. If we are to meet the 2021 vision, we need to break down the barriers to care for those groups. The report highlighted a number of recommendations and common themes that can help us to do just that, so I want to focus on them in my final minute or so. Firstly, the need for more research and data. I'm proud of the fact that the University of Glasgow's End of Life Studies Group is based in my hometown of Dumfries within the Crichton campus. That group, founded in 2014 by the eminent sociologist Professor Clark, who many members know as the author of the Health and Sport Committee's report on palliative care, has done a far-reaching work on research, but there still needs to be a lot more in order to tackle that gap that we have in research and data on palliative care compared with other health issues. Not least the evidence-based for the government to show progress towards that 2021 vision. There's also a need to improve the indicators used by health and social care partnerships to ensure we fully measure the inequities in care that I mentioned earlier. And although it was encouraging to read in the government's commitment in the recently published Health and Social Care Delivery Plan to double palliative and end-of-life provision in the community, I hope the Minister will be able to say something in her summing up about exactly how that will be achieved. Finally, talking about palliative care and dying does not come naturally to many, despite the inevitability of death. So I hope the Minister will also say more this evening about how the government intends to deliver the commitment in the framework to support greater public discussion on death, dying and care at the end of life. As Professor David Clark rightly...
I'm afraid you must close.
Final comment, Presiding Officer.
David
Clark rightly said that our care in the UK and Scotland is world-class, but we need to ensure that world-class care is there for everyone who needs it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Graham Day, to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Mr Day, please.
Presiding Officer, Marie Curie undertakes highly important work in my constituency, as it indeed does across Scotland, offering expert care, guidance and support to those living with a terminal illness to help them get the most from the time they have left. There's no doubt that Marie Curie's staff do a tremendous job, and I thank my friend Linda Fabiani for bringing this debate to the Chamber so we can acknowledge that. Carrying out this work, of course, comes at a substantial cost, though, and I want to use my contribution to acknowledge the very considerable fundraising efforts made by Angus South residents to aid this cause. The local Marie Curie group in Carnoustie alone has raised £25,000 over the last 2 years for the charity. This has seen mountains climbed, cans shaken, tablet and cake made, miles run, and people abseiling off the University of Dundee's tower building, all in order to help this fantastic cause. I don't think so. Additionally, four doctors and two receptionists from Carnoustie Medical Group's Parkview Primary Care Centre last May raised £3,000 for Marie Curie by running distances of 5 and 10 kilometres at Manuki Country Park. On the other side of my constituency in the Sidlaws, we find someone else who has certainly gone the distance and more for Marie Curie. Judith Strachan, along with some friends, undertook a sponsored trek in Peru through the harsh and diverse Andean mountains to reach the 15th century Inca citadel Machu Picchu last year. All told, the four ladies involved raised £16,000, enough to provide 800 hours worth of free, high-quality care. But even that effort has been surpassed by Petra McMillan, who's a Marie Curie patron for Dundee and Angus, until very recently a constituent of mine. All told, since 2009, Petra, her family, her friends, and others in the DD postcode via the Carnoustie and Dundee fundraising groups have raised £250,000 for Marie Curie. Petra began her fundraising efforts following her mum, who had received care from Marie Curie, passing away. The latest challenge saw Petra and her husband complete a grueling cycle of 250 miles from Nicaragua to Costa Rica. She's also climbed Mount Kilimanjaro and cycled from Vietnam to Cambodia in aid of Marie Curie. Add to that efforts she's undertaken in Scotland, including climbing Ben Nevis, walking the West Highland Way, running a marathon, a handful of half marathons for the charity, and you can see the commitment that she has to this cause. The only Marie Curie shop in the northeast of Scotland is located in my constituency in Arbroath. And whilst people may bemoan the number and presence of charity shops in our high street, it should be acknowledged that any money raised for Marie Curie stays within a 25-mile radius of where it originates. I think that resonates with people when it comes to donating or supporting. Across Tayside, 263 patients were seen in over 2,153 visits during 2015-16. That's 2,153 sessions involving nurses working day and night in people's homes, providing hands-on care and vital emotional support. But I was even more struck by another couple of stats revealed by Marie Curie. That is that nationally, 2,500 parents die, leaving 4,100 bereaved children every year in Scotland, and that there are currently 24,000 bereaved children in our country. From the terminal diagnosis of a dear loved one, through having to witness the progressive nature of an illness and treatment, and then grieving, hard enough for adults to cope with, let alone children and young people. According to Marie Curie, many of these children and young people are missing out on post-bereavement support. If that is the case, on any kind of scale, then it's something which needs addressed. Marie Curie, of course, called for the introduction of a national coordinator for childhood bereavement to review and advise on steps to improve bereavement services. The Scottish Government committed to this in its programme for government 2016-17. I very much welcome that, and as Marie Curie does, not only look forward to the appointment of the coordinator later this year, but also seeing what action is taken thereafter. To conclude, Presiding Officer, let me reiterate my thanks to Linda Fabiani for bringing this debate to the Chamber, Marie Curie for the work it does, and the fundraisers, not just in Angus South, but across Scotland, whose efforts make all of this possible. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. Liam MacArthur, to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I too thank and congratulate Linda Fabiani, not just for bringing this now annual debate, for managing to coincide it with International Women's Day, and also securing the hat-trick by moving her first motion to extend a debate. I spoke in this debate, I think, in 2015, and since then, Marie Curie has clearly gone from strength to strength. Every other colleague has mentioned the phenomenal fundraising effort since 1986. But that £80 million, what's important about it is what it enables the staff themselves to do. And I think Linda Fabiani very helpfully reminded us some of the work that's done in the area of mental health, which is perhaps an overlooked aspect of this debate. I want to join others too in putting on record my thanks to the staff and volunteers for all that they do nationally, regionally, and locally for the terminally ill and for the families. I have a personal experience of this around the death of my father-in-law 6 years ago, and the support that we got from Marie Curie was phenomenal. He was a cancer a patient, but obviously Marie Curie's work goes well beyond treatment and care for cancer patients. I note also the work that Marie Curie are developing in terms of the helper service, and while this is a little constrained at the moment, I'd certainly look forward to seeing that rolled out more widely, including perhaps ultimately to my own Orkney constituency. And in keeping with others, I'm going to concentrate some of my remarks on what is happening locally in the islands. It's a relatively new service in Orkney. I'm pleased, however, that since I last spoke in this debate, the coverage has been expanded. It's built from a pilot project started by Dr. Andy Trevitt and his colleagues in the Stromness and the Doomby practices. The patient numbers are still probably relatively small, but the impact has been no less significant. The feedback from patients and families continues to be hugely, hugely positive. And the support in turn from the wider community for this effort, I think, it bears testimony to that. Linda Lenny, who's taken over as the local chair of the volunteer group in Orkney, said in an email to me earlier this week, there's a growing awareness of the work the four nurses do, and this is having a knock-on effect with the donations we are receiving. The generosity of spirit of the Arcadian public never ceases to amaze me. I'm delighted that Linda and the local secretary, Sarah Duncan, are in the gallery. They probably can lay claim to having travelled further than most to be here. And having sat in Kirkwall Airport for going on 6 hours this morning, can I also congratulate Linda and Sarah on having the foresight to come down yesterday rather than this morning, as was initially planned. And can I, for the record, point out that there is no Prosecco available on Loganair flights. Discussions are ongoing with NHS Orkney about rolling out this programme more widely, and I would encourage those discussions to reach a conclusion as quickly as possible. More can be done. As Marie Curie points out, one in four who need palliative care are currently missing out. I rather suspect the figure in Orkney, because of the newness, the relative newness of the service, are probably the figures slightly higher in that regard. This, I think, does run counter to the Scottish Government's palliative care strategy, which I very much welcome. But it's also out of step with the commitments, the collective commitments I think we all have to see delivery of care take place far more routinely within the communities. So a lot more work to be done as we celebrate the work that Marie Curie already do. So can I conclude by thanking again all these staff and volunteers for the remarkable work that they do, not just in Orkney but across the country, giving people the dignity and death that they deserve. And I very much look forward to raising a glass of Prosecco, even George Adams' glass of Prosecco, to the entire volunteer group later on this evening. Thank you very much indeed.
I do hope there's a big enough supply, even if they're mean on the Loganair flights. Can I now call, please, Miles Briggs, to be followed by Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to also congratulate Linda Fabiani on securing the debate this evening. I'm pleased to take part in it. Personally, having been become a new MSP, I don't think I've seen so many people in the public gallery for a members' debate, and it's a fantastic achievement, and you're very much welcome to this, your Scottish Parliament. And can I join Linda also both in encouraging people across Scotland to support the Great Daffodil Appeal, and also in paying a warm tribute to all those involved with Marie Curie, the work they do in providing truly world-class palliative care services. As a Lothian MSP, I'm very much aware of the importance of Marie Curie's services and to many of my constituents. And as someone whose family's used a hospice, I can only just understand the value which that does provide to family members at some of the most difficult times and to their loved ones. I visited Marie Curie's Edinburgh Hospice at Fairmile Head a few months ago and saw firsthand the good work undertaken there and the dedication of the local Marie Curie nurses, other hospice staff and the volunteers, 114 of whom support the work of the hospice. The Edinburgh Hospice serves South Edinburgh, Mid Lothian, West Lothian and had 425 admissions in 2015-16. The difference it makes to people living with a terminal illness as they near the end of their lives and their loved ones who deliver that support and show the support they deliver to their families cannot be overstated and underestimated. It means that 95% of patients supported by Marie Curie in Lothian are able to die in the place of their choice. The hospice also provides an excellent day service for patients who are not admitted. Marie Curie's work in my region is, of course, not just restricted to the hospice, but also takes place in communities and in patients' homes. In 2015-16, 325 patients were cared for in the community in West Lothian and 564 in South Edinburgh and Mid Lothian. In this time, 3,653 community team patient visits were made locally, while more than 400 people benefited from Marie Curie's patient and family support team bereavement support sessions. And I wanted to also highlight, as other members have, Marie Curie's helper service. It's something I only really became aware of recently. The helper service provides a link service to someone to chat to over coffee, helping to run an errand, or simply being there when you need someone to talk to. And I think that's such an important thing we cannot underestimate. And as Linda Fabiani has said, whilst a lot of work is going on, it remains a real concern that one in four Scots are still missing out on palliative care they need. And there's particularly challenges around how we ensure people aged over 85, those who live alone, or those from the BME communities in Scotland, that they are actually delivered this palliative care access as well. As Marie Curie said, we have to see clear progress and evidence to show that the number of people not accessing palliative care are required and actually work to reduce that. As my party spokesman on mental health, I think it's also important to highlight the lack of research in Scotland and indeed access across the UK into how people with severe mental issues who require palliative care, how they actually are receiving the support they need. And I think that's something we've still got a lot of work to do. Recently, as the Deputy Presiding Officer will demonstrate, I undertook a fundraising exercise for Chaz when I had my legs waxed, and that's something I know the particular...
I enjoyed that.
Well, I did know you took particularly delight in your section of that, but I wanted to highlight another constituent's far more important and a pressing exercise, and that was a Luke Robertson, who I know is in the public gallery this evening. Luke's raised over £75,000 for Marie Curie through an expedition last year when he became the youngest Brit, and in fact the first Scot to complete a solo unassisted and unsupported expedition to the South Pole, a grueling 39 days ski across 730 miles of ice and snow in Antarctica. So my leg waxing is nothing compared to that. But to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, can I again welcome today's debate and hope the Marie Curie Daffodil Appeal in 2017 goes on to break record amounts they've raised in the past. And can I, on behalf of the people I represent in the Lothian region who have used the service, and actually for those who have had to use it for their loved ones, say a huge thank you to Marie Curie for the service and support they provide and wish them the very best in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bruce Crawford, before the Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin, as others have done, by sincerely congratulating my friend and colleague Linda Fabiani on securing the debate on such an important subject as the Marie Curie Daffodil Appeal for this evening's members' debate slot. I don't know if Linda knows this, but it's certainly one of the longest motions I think it's ever been submitted to Parliament. It's 351 words, but all of them well crafted, I've got to say, Linda, telling the story of the Marie Curie well. I've just realised, though, that made me sound a bit like Stuart Stevenson. I'm getting a bit worried now. To begin with, though, Linda told her story. I'd like to tell a story of my own about meeting with some of the staff and volunteers from Marie Curie and my own constituency office in Stirling just recently. James, Jennifer, Elizabeth and Joyce came to speak to me about the fabulous and vital work they are doing across Stirling, Forth Valley and indeed across the whole of Scotland. And the discussion was set up by Susan Lowes, who did such a wonderful job for the organisation. The group told me about the care available for residents in the Stirling area who are living with a terminal illness and the support that's also available for their families. As we know, Marie Curie provide care and support for people with a whole range of terminal illnesses, whether that's dementia, heart failure, cancer, MND, frailty, and increasingly more and more people with multiple health conditions. And I also heard about how the local Marie Curie nurses work night and day, providing hands-on care and emotional support, enabling patients to be cared for and to die at home, where that's their choice and obviously where that's appropriate to do so. Now, everyone knows that the death of a loved one is something that's always extremely difficult, particularly, though, I think, when they were suffering from a terminal illness over a long period of time. The nurses at Marie Curie do absolutely everything they can to make the last few weeks, days and hours as comfortable as humanly possible, not just for the patient, but for their family and friends. And in 2015-16, across NHS Forth Valley and Moan area, 200 people were supported with 1,424 nursing visitors. Now, when I met the representatives from Marie Curie a few weeks ago, just let me complete a bit of that story, because just as the group were leaving, one of my staff members came through to speak to them. And one of the nurses who'd looked after the mother of one of my team in the days before she passed away had been there the night before she died. It was a very emotional moment for everyone in my office. It had been the first time that they had met each other since the home visit had been made by the nurse. I don't imagine, though, that that's a one-off experience in life for people, because Marie Curie nurses are welcome into people's homes during some of the most difficult times in a person's life. Yet they enter with respect for the patient and family, providing care and kindness and much-needed support to all. I saw just how much it meant for both my staff member and the nurse in a few moments I'll never forget. Now, of course, in order to continue the charity, they are dependent upon the generous donations that they receive from fundraising. And as others have said, Marie Curie has supported over 85 local community fundraising groups in Scotland and helped to raise £4 million each year, enabling them to provide much of their caring services. And I want to put on my record my full support for the charity's fundraising groups in Stirling, who are hard at work making sure Marie Curie are able to continue caring for the people in the local area. And I know that locally in Stirling, that small group have raised £27,000 alone themselves. That's quite remarkable. Now, later this year, my office and myself will be taking part in the Blooming Great Tea Party to raise money for the Marie Curie cause. I'm told by Susan Lowes from Marie Curie that the Blooming Great Tea Party is all about the right ingredients, nice cuppas, naughty cakes, bad jokes and good conversation. I'm sure I can provide at least some of these, but I'm not promising to provide any of the Prosecco I've been hearing about the site this evening. So it's all about having a blooming great time while raising money for a blooming great cause. And in closing, can I just say to all of the wonderful staff and volunteers at Marie Curie, thank you on behalf of everyone in Scotland, and encourage all of my colleagues to sign up to the Tea Party for such a fabulous cause. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Call Anna Sarward, be followed by David Torrance. Mr. Sarward, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by saying people might start talking about me and Linda Fabiani, because I have noticed on occasion Linda Fabiani nodding vigorously when I've been speaking. Some of our colleagues might not be happy to hear that, but I noticed myself nodding vigorously back as Linda was opening this debate today. So a sincere and genuine thank you to Linda Fabiani for bringing forward this really, really important debate to this chamber. I think we've heard from every speaker today that we want to send one unified message, regardless of any political party, to each and every single member of staff or volunteer right across Marie Curie. A sincere thank you. A thank you for caring for our loved ones at the most difficult periods in their lives. But I think it's also important to recognise, as Jill, who is a palliative care nurse in the Glasgow Hospice, reminded me this afternoon, that you not just care for the person that is dying, but you actually care for that family as well at that most difficult time of need. You care for that person, you care for that family, and also you advocate. And I think that's the part that's also sometimes missed, is that sometimes we think that Marie Curie only looks after people in the most difficult period. But actually what Marie Curie does all year round is advocate to parliamentarians in this place and in other places about what more we can do as decision makers to help support some of the most vulnerable people in our communities and how we can actually put palliative care on the agenda. So to each and every single one of you, to your hundreds of staff, to your thousands of volunteers, thank you from the bottom of our hearts for every single thing you do. And I'm sure all of us have been touched by Marie Curie. If we haven't, I'm sure at some point of our lives, we will be touched by Marie Curie and their fantastic staff. Because the other thing that they've helped do, Deputy Presiding Officer, is take away the discussion purely from good health, but actually to how we talk about how people die with dignity and get the support that they need, how we put patients at the centre of our care needs, how we prioritise for them where they wished to spend their final days and moments in this world and also with their family members, asking them what's important to them. I think quite often it's easy for us as parliamentarians to think it's simply about medicating or operating and being in hospital, but actually asking patients what matters to them, whether it be preparing for a will, whether it be preparing for the experience for their children, or where they want to spend, as I say, those final days. So again, thank you for that. That what matters to you test to each and every single individual patient. I had the pleasure of meeting an individual who I want to speak about, Richard Fairbairns, at our party conference, not last weekend, the weekend before, nicknamed Pops. So with his permission, I'll call him Pops as well today. And he very powerfully talked about how actually individuals who work in our NHS, having the time to care for an individual is so important. Having an adequately numbered and enforced workforce to care and to give that information, to provide a care plan, to partner with the family members, makes such an absolute difference to people. And also how we need to make sure that we represent people, whether they be in urban areas, but also in rural areas. He himself was from Mull, so how we involve island communities as well in that very important issues around palliative care. So in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, I just want to put on the record a sincere thank you to every single staff member and volunteer of Marie Curie. Thank you for every single thing that you've done. And I'm sure there are hundreds of thousands of people across the UK who look to Marie Curie with pride and a sincere thanks.
Thank you. I call David Torrance, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to thank Linda Fabiani for securing this debate in the Chamber today, welcoming the Great Daffodil Appeal, Marie Curie's biggest annual fundraising event. And can I welcome all volunteers to Parliament today, especially representatives from Kirkcaldy constituency. Each year, the Daffodil Appeal raises over £4 million in Scotland to help 200 Marie Curie nurses working across Scotland care for and support people with terminal illnesses, as well as emotional support for families, friends and the wider community. The charity had made immense contributions to Scotland since it was founded in 1948, the same year as the NHS was established, and actually provides the largest number of hospice beds outside the NHS. From 2015 to 2016, 1,863 well-trained volunteers in Scotland were involved in fundraising for their communities and their local shops. Not only does Marie Curie offer nurses that provide hands-on care and hospice, and offer friendly environments, but they also help everyone affected by terminal illnesses get the information and support that they need through the research they carry out to help improve care and support. These services all come from amazing work of volunteers and fundraisers, especially from the Daffodil Appeal. Since 1986, the Daffodil Appeal has raised over £80 million and has contributed to giving people a better quality of life. These achievements would not have made it possible without the help of thousands of volunteers. We make fundamental contributions to provide good quality care. Marie Curie's survival and success is dependent on the dedication and hard work of those volunteers who dedicate their time and special skills to help others in need. Volunteering also allows us to get involved with new things, environment and experiences, create a better environment for others, as well as create healthier communities, meet a wide variety of people from all sorts of walks of life, and create networks and connections. Valuable insights and sense of accomplishment and build potential future career options. In this way, volunteering is a two-way street. Both volunteers and patients benefit. The economic value in volunteering saves millions of pounds that can be used to ensure that the services that Marie Curie and its volunteers provide are the best that they can be and can provide one-to-one emotional support, tackling social isolation as well as providing companionship. In my own constituency, trained volunteers provide a unique one-to-one service. In 2014, Marie Curie partners up with NHS Fife to deliver tailored care and support at home for terminally ill in Fife and their families. In 2015-2016, 21 Marie Curie nurses cared for 318 patients and a total of 4,255 visits. This vital support allowed 94% of these patients to die with dignity in the place of their choice. The scheme works alongside other services and initiatives in Fife's area in order to meet individualised needs of patients and families. This is a great example of partnership approach to providing health and emotional support services at what can be an extremely difficult time, not only for patients, but for families and the wider community. I'm extremely proud of the contributions that the Kirkcaldy Funding Group has made since their inception in 2014. They have raised vital funds of over 11,000. As well as spreading awareness, they have organised many events and activities within the community and also participated in the town's Beach Highland Games. Last year's event, a fashion show organised by a group, was extremely successful, raising £1,000 for the charity. Again, volunteers are a vital part of Marie Curie's Fife service by offering companionship and emotional support, providing practical help such as aiding patients with small tasks, spend time with patients to allow their families and carers a break, and helping people and their families find further support and services that are ready, accessible and available to them locally. Without volunteers, Marie Curie would not be able to deliver a range of services and support that they do. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'd like to once again thank Linda Fabiani for securing this debate. During the month of March, I would encourage everyone to give a small donation and wear a daffodil pin to raise awareness as well as to promote the Great Daffodil Appeal.
Thank you very much. I call Kenneth Gibson, last speaker in the open debate. Mr Gibson, please.
Presiding Officer, I too would like to warmly thank Linda Fabiani for lodging this motion and securing this debate. The work of supporting and helping people suffering from terminal illness is what Marie Curie Scotland does best. And last year, 11 Marie Curie nurses in NHS Ayrshire and Arran helped 86 patients over 354 visits, providing a 24/7 planned nursing service. Beyond the direct help they offer to patients and their families, Marie Curie also helped relieve pressure on the NHS and is an essential partner in taking care of terminally ill patients. And the charity works to help build a fairer and healthier Scotland by delivering services, support and information. Marie Curie raises funds in numerous ways, most famously through its daffodil appeal. When I first wore a daffodil some 30 or so years ago, people keep coming up to me and asking me if it was St David's Day. I'm pleased to say no one asks me that now. Marie Curie has a network of shops, one of which in Saulcoats is in my constituency, where I volunteered for a day back in 2015. And I commend the work of all 1,863 Marie Curie volunteers across Scotland, people who don't just put in a day, but give of their time week in, week out, year after year. Marie Curie addresses human vulnerability and the right to die with dignity where a person wants to, surrounded by loved ones. This is an elementary right, and 94% of patients supported by Marie Curie in Ayrshire who passed away last year did so in their place of choice. Marie Curie offers a large range of services for thousands of people living with terminal illness and their families, from home nursing care to Marie Curie hospices, from medical care to patients to psychological support for the carers. Individuals are supported not only from life to death, but also after death by helping the family in their grief and administer to formalities which can be daunting. Marie Curie's Great Daffodil Appeal is an occasion not only to raise money for services and research, but also raise public awareness about terminal illness, a matter little discussed in public. Research investment is vital. Only 0.16% of charitable and government research funding in the UK is spent on end-of-life care, and a fifth of that is invested by Marie Curie. It's estimated that around 40,000 of the 54,000 people who die each year in Scotland need palliative care. Unfortunately, with inequalities combined with a lack of information and appropriate infrastructure, around 11,000 are deprived of this elementary service. We need to improve palliative care by promoting innovation in this field, especially knowing that 1 in 8 people will be 75 or over by 2031. With this in mind, the Scottish Government's Strategic Framework for Action, Palliative and End-of-Life Care aims to improve the system with the goal of offering palliative care to anyone who needs it by 2021.
The objectives outlined in the strategy are not only quantitative but qualitative. The key is to bring to more people the care required to cope with a terminal illness. In recent months, I've heard the concerns of constituents taking care of a terminally ill relative and confronted with intolerable delays when accessing the benefits to which they're entitled. Marie Curie highlights these difficulties and recommends the development of a fast-track system for those who are terminally ill. The personal independence payment is a step towards this, allowing the terminally ill person or his or her representative to fill in fewer forms than normal, and the DWP will fast-track the application. However, the PIP can be useless in certain cases when a DS1500 report cannot be attached to its application. This report must be completed by a doctor, GP or consultant who confirmed the terminal illness. Sometimes such a diagnosis cannot be delivered by the core medical team, and the patient finds him or herself in circumstances where they cannot access help. I believe the current system needs to be improved to help all patients, regardless of their diagnosis, and I support the recommendation of the Marie Curie report for developing a fast-track process within a DWP. And more generally, I will say that the spirit of speeding up the administrative process for those who are dying and their families should be extended to every level of administration from communities to national level. Presiding Officer, I believe that Scottish Ministers and this Parliament must make the best possible effort to help families confronted with such issues, to listen to them and ensure they are helped by the appropriate services. I commend the work of Marie Curie Scotland, particularly in my Cunninghamworth constituency, and once again thank Linda Fabiani for bringing this debate to the Chamber.
Thank you. You're ready. I call on Eileen Campbell to close for the Government. Minister, 7 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too would like to thank Linda Fabiani for bringing this motion to the Chamber this evening. And Linda is absolutely right. Today offers us a chance to celebrate the fabulous Great Daffodil Appeal, now in its 31st year, but also a chance to celebrate what volunteers do. And Linda is right, it is wonderful to see some of them here tonight, and I think she described it as a beautiful host of golden daffodils, and she's absolutely right to make that point. And I would also like to give a special thanks to all the people right across Scotland whose generosity over the years has helped to make the Marie Curie Great Daffodil Appeal such an extraordinary success. And many members have discussed those local efforts tonight, David Torrens, Liam McKerr, Liam MacArthur, I apologise. Getting my Liams mixed up there, sorry. You can just put your hand on your hip, then we might remember. Kenny Gibson, Miles Briggs, George Adam, Graham Day, a whole host of people talking about how important the local effort is in terms of making the appeal such a success. And Donald Cameron and Rona Mackay are also right to acknowledge the woman, Marie Curie, on International Women's Day. So many inspiring women and their work have been lost through history, but not Marie Curie, whose dedication, her intelligence, her strength and her commitment and the charity in her name ensure an enduring legacy. And I'm sure that we all agree that the work done by Marie Curie in Scotland is invaluable. Their expertise in the field of palliative and end-of-life care is renowned, and they fulfil a vital role in supporting not only those nearing the end of their lives, but also to the multitude of families and friends surrounding them. And I had the opportunity at the beginning of this year to hear more about the work of Marie Curie in my own constituency, and the sheer breadth of that work being undertaken is truly phenomenal. The skilled care they provide is more important than ever, as the demand for such services is only going to increase due to the well-understood changes in our population. We have more people in Scotland living longer, and that's a good thing. But as we grow older, more of us tend to grow frailer, with multiple long-term conditions involving specific palliative care needs. And we all want a fairer, healthier Scotland, and the Marie Curie Great Daffodil Appeal presents a timely opportunity for us to reflect on the challenges that we face and which we are taking concrete steps to address. We are committed to understanding the needs of our different communities. We want to remove discrimination, reduce inequality, protect human rights and build good relations by breaking down barriers that may hinder people and prevent them from accessing the care and services and the supports that they need. And that's a point I think was made well by Colin Smith, and I pay tribute to him for his long-standing commitment on this agenda. Scotland is already a world leader in the field of palliative and end-of-life care, and I'm proud of the progress that we've made over the past few years, increasing the numbers of specialist staff, improving access to services, and through our programme of health and social care integration, putting services under the control of our local communities. Through this work, people are enjoying greater choice and control over their care, and as a result, pressure on NHS acute care units has been reduced, families and carers are better supported, and most importantly, the people who could benefit from palliative and end-of-life care are increasingly receiving it. However, there is no complacency, absolutely no complacency, and we absolutely understand there is far more to do on this.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank the Minister for giving way. I think she's right in terms of what she's saying around acute care. I think one of the concerns that's mentioned in Orkney and I think across a number of health boards is a frustration that the finance isn't moving further into the primary sector and allowing more of this care to take place in the community and funded in order to do so. Is that something the government has a focus on?
Minister.
Absolutely. I think we all kind of agree that there is that need to kind of move and shift the resource to primary care and to have preventative kind of efforts put in place. And I think, and I recognise that that is a big shift, it is a big challenge. And it's a challenge for communities and rural and remote communities as well, and the one that Liam MacArthur represents. And certainly that is something that the government is keenly aware of and is working hard to build momentum in. The Scottish Government is committed to working with organisations like Marie Curie to take forward that shared aim of ensuring that everyone in Scotland who would benefit from palliative and end-of-life care has access to it by 2021. An ambitious goal, but we are absolutely right to be ambitious on this area. And in December 2015, in response to a World Health Assembly resolution which required all governments to recognise palliative care and make provision for it in their national health policies, we published our strategic framework for palliative and end-of-life care. And this framework set out a number of commitments designed to improve the quality and availability of palliative and end-of-life care across Scotland. And we committed £3.5 million over 4 years towards realising that vision. However, to achieve this vision, it is essential that we also create the right conditions nationally to support the local communities in their planning and delivery of palliative and end-of-life care. So I think, again, echoing the point that Liam MacArthur raises, to help ensure that the unique needs of individuals are met. And this ethos is at the very heart of health and social care integration. Integration authorities are working with local communities and building on the expertise of organisations like Marie Curie to commission services that are designed to meet the palliative and end-of-care life needs of their local community. And by commissioning services in this way, improvements will be driven through meaningful collaborative partnerships with the palliative and end-of-life care community, and importantly, with the extraordinarily passionate and committed individuals who work tirelessly to improve support for end-of-life care for so many. And as are set out in our strategic framework, we have asked Healthcare Improvement Scotland to test and implement improvements in the access to and the delivery of palliative and end-of-life care. And that work includes developing better ways to identify all those who might benefit from palliative and end-of-life care, especially the frail and elderly. Many members have also raised data, and data is vital because without it, we won't know whether people are getting the palliative and end-of-life care that they need. And without it, local communities can't commission the services needed to support people's care, and care plans will remain hard to share. This data challenge is recognised in our framework, which includes a commitment to support improvements in the collection, the analysis, the interpretation and dissemination of data and evidence relating to the needs, the provision, the activity, the indicators and outcomes in respect of palliative and end-of-life care. And there's a working group tasked with clarifying that data requirements to ensure that they are valuable for both individuals receiving care and to integration authorities. Working with NHS Information Services Division, the data group are also investigating a number of areas where data collection can be used and improved. And additionally, our mental health strategy due to be published shortly, which is due to be published shortly, and the Marie Curie report Enough for Everyone, which was published last autumn, will also be helpful in informing that work and assisting in making sure that the needs of those with mental health conditions are considered in the implementation of the strategic framework. And a point that I think was sensitively and absolutely correctly raised by Linda Fabiani in recognising the mental health needs of carers and also those that are being cared for. I want to just turn very briefly as well to the values and skills that people need from our health and social care staff. And Colin Smith and Kenny Gibson also recognise how hard we find it as a nation to discuss death and dying. Yet it is the skill at having these difficult conversations which is absolutely critical for anticipatory care planning conversations. And having these conversations and sharing what matters to the person at their end of life can make all the difference to how and where they die. And that ties, I think, also in part to the points raised by Anas Sarwar. And although he didn't explicitly say it, I think what he was also saying was it resonates very strongly with the realistic medicine approach that's set out by our CMO. And last week as well, which I think is part of this community empowerment approach to palliative care, I was very privileged to be at the launch of Compassionate Inverclyde, which embodies the ethos of whole communities coming together to support each other with compassion at points of grief and loss and change. And it builds on the skills and the assets of a community and opens up that discussion about death and dying. Finally, I just want to say a wee bit about palliative care research. As part of the programme of work set out in our strategic framework, we have established a research forum which focuses on the research associated with the strategic aims of the framework. And it also helps to bring that research to bear on shaping the commissioning, the improvement and the education of palliative care in Scotland. We've also recently provided funding to the forum to support Marie Curie and colleagues in the University of Edinburgh, including Professor Scott. And I would certainly recommend to Colin, I think has a real interest in this area, and Linda Fabiani also, to listen to Professor Scott and his way to communicate with a great deal of passion on this area. But what we've done in that funding of that work is to undertake a systematic review of over 400 relevant research studies undertaken in Scotland, and that will also help deliver a clearer picture of research and the data gaps and to support improvement in this work. And in acknowledgement of the collaborative nature of the work in this field, in May we'll also be jointly sponsoring a seminar with Marie Curie, which will provide a forum to explore other areas of research that will help us move forward with the framework's action plans. So to conclude, this has been an incredibly informed and instructive debate that rightly acknowledges progress made on palliative care, but is also recognising the challenges that remain. We across the Parliament are unified in our need to approach palliative care through a public health lens, and we're also united in our appreciation of the work and dedication of the volunteers and the Marie Curie workers right across Scotland. Whether it's holding a hand, embracing someone in the most difficult of time, which costs nothing, but in terms of the support that that offers to an individual and a family is absolutely priceless. It is a special opportunity for us tonight to come together as a Parliament and simply say thank you to everyone involved with Marie Curie, and that please know that we do that on behalf of everyone right across the country.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.